It's an amazing thing when we go through awakenings, and that's constant on Earth. You know, you don't have one. There are moments when people talk about the sacred experiences of, for example, Buddha or Jesus. What's the sacred one that we remember about Buddha? Sometimes it's he was sitting under the Bodhi tree and reaches enlightenment. That is a very important part of his life, but it's also important to remember the moment where he decided the world does not have the answers. Even though that's a confused moment, a desperate moment, it's still a very pivotal moment. So it doesn't always have to be the clouds parting and angels coming through and all that to signify our grand awakenings. Some of our greatest awakenings are when we see something isn't working. Not just the what is and will work, but what isn't working. It's just that those are sometimes a bit of an inconvenience to our mind, to our hearts. I mean, God, I've been putting all this energy. I went and got this career that my parents hoped I would, and I found out I don't like it. Oh, they're going to be so mad. That's all right. Let them be mad. If they're really mad and crazy about it, move. Change your number. I mean, there's easy things you can do. But the world is changing. The population is exploding like it's never done in history. And there are folks saying, well, what kind of careers? That, you know, some people talk about we're having a prosperous time. Other people see it as a lack time. But, you know, what's going on? And what's going to happen if there's soon going to be 10 billion people on the planet before we know it? Within 100 years, it should be, you know? What are we going to do? What careers are going to be there? Well, worrying about that stuff isn't necessary. What I do know is, the more we recognize that we're here to be the light of God, our soul's purpose starts opening up to us. If nothing else the world has taught us in the last several years, one of the key pieces is that it offers nothing including security, including jobs, job security. There are still human beings, no offense if this is you, but there are still human beings that actually think they should be working till they die so that they can make enough money to put into an account for their kids to go to college. For what purpose? They're not going to like you anyway at the end of the day. You know, they're going to have some sort of issue with you. They're going to need therapy because you sent them to college. You made it too easy for me. You know, don't send them to college. Oh, you made things too hard for me. I need therapy. So the world is not what it was, and it never was, but now we're seeing it. Living just to die isn't why we're here. Living just to send your kids to college is not why we're here. People are realizing college did not offer them the security and certainly not necessarily the happiness. We're here to have a soul's purpose. We're souls. So are souls supposed to get a career or a soul's purpose? Think of the wording. I'm here to know my soul's purpose. There needs to be universities, Soul's Purpose University. SPU, you know? Yeah, I go to Soul's Purpose University. That's what you should be doing. Find out what you're about. The Essene community, the eccentric, metaphysical, Gnostic, you know, sect of people living at Jesus's time. They used to, children are born, they do charts and find out what the child's going to be like and design a life for them to go in that direction. Whatever happened to the world that made them say, wow, such a beautiful child we have, honey. Look how creative they look, such naturals. They know how to mix color. They're just brilliant. They need to be an accountant. What happened in the human brain that brought us to that place? I want them to do what I want them to do. You know, it doesn't really make sense. And it's not the joy of God. So God's sending us messages to guide us in the right direction. And human beings live in this strange distrust of God. If only I knew, you know, and it's one of those stories where God's like, what? If only I knew what you wanted me to do. I told you when I gave you crayons when you were 3. I told you when you used to watch all creative shows and not violent shows. I told you when I introduced you constantly to how exciting it is to feel feelings and not only think. I showed you. I told you you were an artist. I told you you were creative. I'm not the one who decided to live in fear, mom, dad won't let me, and do what they want me to do. And it's not just mom, dad, I'm just using that as a metaphor. But we've had our opportunities, and they're still there. This is one of the weirdest things. This talk is not necessarily on soul's purpose, but I want to get this piece out there. Most people, everyone has a soul's purpose to some degree or another. Sometimes it looks really grand and other times simpler. But when people say, show me my soul's purpose, Michael, tell me my soul's purpose. How do I find my soul's purpose? The classes I do, you know? Every January we do this great co-creating a new life online course. It's brilliant. And everybody can get more in touch with what they're here to do and who they are and so on. Brilliant. Every January. And people ask, it's a common question. In the world, one of the common questions is typically about relationships. But in the spiritual community, soul's purpose is one of the most commonly asked questions. And this is what's weird. I can help you tune into it, and I will. In that course, we do that and all that. But one of the simplest things is most of us were told all our lives that we were great at something, and usually that something is related to our soul's purpose. So you'll go through, you'll become 90 and do a workshop where someone says, your soul's purpose is beautification through landscape design. Oh, that's weird. I took landscaping in high school and everybody said I was a natural. And here you are, 90 years, 80, 70 years later, and now learning your soul's purpose. It's weird because we always knew, we were told. When people said, you're a great listener, you see? When I met a couple of people, I've only met a couple of people since high school, and one of them was a mom of a person I knew. She said, well, what are you doing? And I'm like, oh, geez, how do I answer that? So I always go with the safe answer, because if you say counselor, that's something they at least know. So counselor, And this mom, who knew me when I was 17, said, oh, that totally makes sense. I haven't seen her since I was 17. And all these years later, oh, that totally makes sense. I go, what do you mean? Oh, I used to send my daughter to you. I used to tell her whenever she was having one of her tizzies and throwing her tantrums and we couldn't talk to her because, that young daughter of ours, she was really a pain. She said, we used to just say, call that Michael guy. You always seem to feel better after you talk to him. And I'm like, wow, someone knew my soul's purpose before I did. They didn't know to name it, and I didn't know to hear it. But everything's actually right here, and we just don't see it. And one of the things that's right here is God. We have to learn to trust in God, but we've done everything but that. We don't trust in God mainly because, first of all, where is it? Where's God? I mean, I'm going to trust in something I haven't seen it lately. I haven't heard vividly its voice lately. The news on TV actually speaks louder than God. It does. Turn on the news and tell me which one you hear. God's going, oh no, you hear me in the silence. Oh, thank you. That helps a lot. When I'm watching the news and hearing all these terrible things, I need you to be louder than the news. Not going to work that way. So the problem is we don't see God. The second problem is it doesn't tend to do things the way we want it. And there's an amazing reason for that. Why don't I get what I want? Why can't I have the miracles when I'm looking for them? It's an amazing reason for that. It's actually very rational, and most of us don't even know how and why it happened. Here's how it works. I can't see you, God. And God's going, excellent. No, it's not excellent. I'm saying I want to see you, and I want to hear you. Isn't that what it's supposed to be like when you're close to God? No, God says no. You must have read the wrong memo. Then why can't we see you? We would believe in you if only we could see you. And God's saying, if I could let you see me, you would start believing me in a thing, being a thing or a being. And I'm not. Why would I lie to you? If you want to see me, you have to learn to see the unseen. You have to have spiritual sight. Oh, you mean we have to grow spiritually? What an inconvenience again. If you want to see God, God is not a being. Stop looking at beings and look to the invisible. Look to feelings. Look to love and joy if you want to see God. It's not with eyes. So that's why we hear faith in things unseen. That's not like just a cool like Christian reading from the Bible. It's actually a training. God says, you will not see me because I want you to not see. I want you to feel. I want you to learn to experience me. You have to come to me. I'm not going to materialize because then I'll be part of the problem. Jesus himself said, this means the temp, okay? Sorry. Had station identification break, sorry. But she's just, I'm signaling her to take care of the air because it's getting cool for some of you. And she's like, notes and notes. So it's an amazing thing. Think about this. They're in A Course in Miracles, you're hearing, God will not answer your prayers if they'll cause you fear. And we go, and it's mixed sense. So don't ask for anything that would make you afraid. And some of us go, I don't know of anything that's scary about the lottery. I mean, can I just have the lottery? I'm not afraid at all. In case you didn't, I'm not afraid at all. And then your prayers. Oh, Father, Mother, God, I am so not afraid of winning the lottery. Because as though you're thinking it's literal about fear. A Course in Miracles tells you there's only love, and then we make believe in something called fear, which is that the fear of love is not there, that we fear love is not there. So listen, there's only love, and then there's fear. Fear that God or love is not present. That's all there is in the universe. The fear that God isn't, that love isn't present, that prosperity isn't present, is what causes all the symptoms of those things actually looking like they're here. Then we start to look at those things as our gauge. But those things are actually hallucinations of being separated from God. So we're asking God, listen, give us something that will alleviate how we feel about being separate. And God's going, start affirming that you're not separate. What you want is an aspirin. What you want is something that will deaden the nerves to make you think you don't have a headache. What you want is a car because you think that's what you need. That's what it meant when Jesus was saying, you pray, but understand this, God already knows what you need. And here's what humans do. Because we keep trying to make God in our image instead of the other way around. So we say, well, God, okay, let's see. I'm supposed to pray, not be afraid, so I got to remember to say, I'm not afraid of the lottery. That's not what it means. Jesus says, God already knows what you need, so that means God knows I need the lottery. See, I just keep projecting my translations. That's not what it meant. Listen, God, I know you already know this. My ex, they left me last week, and I know you already know this. I would like them back, but I don't need to say so, even though I just did. I don't need to say so because you already know what we need. And God's going, I know exactly what you need. Say bon voyage. This is what you need. I want them back. Oh, I don't do wants. I do what's right. What is the greatest good? So it's a completely different lifestyle. So part of my point in this is that we're hearing even from Jesus, God knows what you need. It means there's only one thing, and that is we have forgotten our divinity, and it screws up our lives. So the only thing we really need is, it's called remembering. That's why Buddha said the problem is amnesia, the solution is remembering. It's really it. Amnesia, remembering. And we think the solution is, I want to go to college, I want money, I want this, I want my partnership, I want this. We have a little grocery list of things we think will help us. And that's why we don't trust God. We can't see God, and it's not giving us what we want. But that's perfect, because God's saying, if I gave you what you want, it would cause you fear, meaning not fear like phobia of winning the lottery. What he means is it will perpetuate the fear that you're separate from God. If you think you need a thing, and God says, I'll give you the thing, it perpetuates the fear of separation. How? Because it just enabled your codependence in that thing. That's what it means. Oh man, this is big stuff. Because now all of a sudden it's, I don't know what to pray for. That's good. That's a good affirmation. No, I need to know what to pray for. Shh. Stay in the I don't know. I don't even know what to pray for. As the Course says, I have forgotten what to ask. That humility, that simplicity is what we're looking for. I do not know. When God has manifested to people in the forms of things like, not God per se, but messengers like angels, our mind has to be receptive to that. We have to be in that humble state. But if you think the New Age coming to fruition rests on things happening for us, like more angel visions, more seeing auras, you're actually then still having false idols because you want to see auras. There's only one thing we should be looking for, praying for. Oneness with God. Remembrance. That's it. And then it gives us everything else. So this next piece is this. God has this really bizarre way of saying, here's how I work. Whether it's call it Christ or the Holy Spirit, the Divine Mother, here's how they work. They make deals with us in a good kind of a way. So understand, here's how God works. God in whatever form, even angels, they make deals. But if you were talking and interviewing Christ and said, what do I need to do to get something? What kind of prayer works? What's the real deal here? It would say this. I know what you really need, and you think you need something. I'm going to make some arrangements to help you get what you think you need if you'll give me what I want. I knew there was something in there. All right, what do you want? Do I have to become a priest again? I did that in another lifetime. I devoted myself to you. Know, is because when we think God wants something from us, it sounds always heavy. Oh, that's right. God's will, that usually doesn't go well. I mean, Jesus said, let God's will be done. And he was on a cross hours later. You know, I don't mean to sound irreverent, but, you know, come on, Lord, not looking good. You need a different agent or something because the PR machine is not looking good. What does God give you when you say your will? Because our eyes think that Jesus died hours later when Jesus said, let your will be done. But when he did this and he's crucified and resurrects, he confirms that no law, including death, has power over you. That nothing of the three-dimensional world has power over you. Was that worth it? Yes. If we would have only been thinking about his survival, it looks like he lost. But he made the choice to say, survival is not my goal. I want to release all of humanity from the belief in illusion. It's worth it. And whether it's you or me or Mother Teresa or whomever, it's always worth it. We just don't know it at the time. And so again, God or Spirit is saying, I'll give you what you want, but I want you to give me what I want. Okay, fine. I need to clear that negative stigma that that's a negative thing. What is it you want, God? You to be home. You to be God again, to remember who you are. Seriously? That's it? Okay, well, okay. And the lottery, right? And God says, if you know who you are, the lottery would be nothing. It would be easy to manifest the lottery. The problem is, you keep doing these subtle bargainings, God is saying to us, you keep doing these subtle bargains that say, as soon as I get that lottery, I promise I'll start working on that spiritual consciousness. So God's saying, you are only consciousness. You are only consciousness. You don't have a body, you don't have needs, and you don't have lotteries. They don't exist. You are really only consciousness. So what do you think I want? You to have consciousness. That's all. And if you let me help you gain higher consciousness, you're going to find that the things of life will start coming even more naturally to you. So you'll get what you want if you'll give me what I'm looking for. And what I'm looking for is not for me. The bargain is actually amazingly unconditional. You know, when I raised my children, when they were young and all that, I would say to them things like that. And it's a smart, from a counseling, psychotherapy even standpoint, it's a smart thing to do with kids. But I would say to them, all right, look, you know, I gave you things when you were little, you know, but once you reach teens, guys, we have to make a deal here. And they would be like, well, that's not fair. You spoiled us for too long. We still want everything to be just, you know, easy. That's fine. But there's some things I want in return. But it would be interesting because what I would ask for in return was actually still in their favor. But they're things they didn't know how to ask for yet. They're not things they knew how to appreciate yet. Do you see what I'm saying? I didn't say, give me this and then I'll give you that, like some arrogant deal-making parent. The deals I would make would be positive. When they got older and became, you know, young adults, I would say to them, if you guys ever want massage, cranial sacral work, acupuncture, I'll pay for it. You see, that's what I mean in this. I'm not actually gaining. It's not like if you guys want body work, I'll tell you what, you have to come over and trim the trees in my yard first. That would be a, you know, give and take. I would say you can go get the work done and I'll even pay for it. That's my deal. You see what I'm saying? It's win-win really for them. God's saying the same thing to us. If you would just ask for the consciousness, that's what I'll help you get. And then you'll get all the other stuff too. But we don't allow ourselves to trust God. We don't allow ourselves to say, well, if it's unseen, I don't know for sure that it's going to work. I don't know for sure I'm going to get it. But that's part of our learning to develop trust in God. We've got to get back to that trust. Not just saying it, but truly believing it. Examine your own life and see how not I trust God. Where and where not is my trust for God? And so again, when we say I would like a little something in my life, why don't I sometimes get it? You're not getting it. God's never out there going, well, this is probably bad for you, per se. What's really happening all too often is, what is it again you want? Oh, you want this? Here's what happens. Then God says, okay, great. You want a car. I'm not concerned about cars. I'm concerned about consciousness. We deal in consciousness here in heaven. So when you say you want a car or a soulmate or whatever you think you want in your life, you state what it is, and I'm going to start setting up all the lessons to help you get there. No, I'm not going to speak into the owner of the car lot's mind and say, give Josie a new car today. They're going to walk in when they say their name, go, God told me to give you a car. That's not how it usually works. Instead, I would like this car. And it's all going to be designed. Your lack of believing you deserve a car. Your fear of making the payments. All of your stuff starts coming up. That's really messed up. I just want the car. I didn't ask to be looking at my inner issues. But God's saying, please, hang in there, because this is how you get back to knowing who you are. Shed all the lies. Shed your misbeliefs that you don't deserve. It's really an amazing thing. So when we think we're not getting, it's because stuff is being set up for us to earn consciousness. So that God doesn't say, I just give you toys, that's Santa. God says, I want you to gain the consciousness so that you're empowered to get the things you think you want. But if you get the consciousness, you'll get them. Humans don't want to hear that. That's why we don't see and feel God as much as we would like. And then we use that as an excuse to not trust God. What's under it is there's a lot under it. There's a whole story under it. We don't want to see and feel God because we have a tantrum going. We want what we want. You really want to see God? Then you have to let go of that which is not God. How can you have judgments and see God at the same time? How can you hate anyone and see God? It doesn't really make any sense. The Old Testament said, and it's mentioned in the New Testament too, but the Old Testament says, you know, there's this whole like unworthiness to seeing God. And again, God's saying, let me help you with that. Not let me force you to see me, but let me teach you your worthiness. As soon as you get the worthiness, everything starts kind of unfolding. And the Old Testament says, when the Messiah comes, they shall call him Emmanuel. And there are people out there that say, we're waiting for Emmanuel. He's got to be called Emmanuel, then we'll know it's him. No, the Bible said clearly, they shall call him Emmanuel, which means, so it was a symbol. And the word meant, God is with us. And other than Jesus, there's one other character in history that most exemplified, God is actually here. embodied, and that was Krishna, a seemingly mythological type character who shows, here's the archetype of God on earth, that divinity. Look at the paintings, the glow, constantly this air of beauty. Even in battle, there's this like, let's go. Do everything with the presence of love. And if somebody's falling, help them get up. And if someone's coming, a force, an army to destroy, start shooting some arrows. Say no to unhealthy things. Say no to your addictions and say no to that army that's trying to kill all of you. Stand up, be counted. And love, 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 love. He's just this presence of love. It's a beautiful depiction. And it doesn't fit, as an archetype, it doesn't fit everybody. We're not all going to be Krishna. We're not all going to dress like him and look like him and so on and so on. It's the ideal. Jesus comes and lives it and embodies it. But it's going to look a little different. It won't be exact. But my point is, God is with us means that when Jesus comes and embodies the whole Krishna, Christ, Krishna archetype, any man or woman can step into that archetype and live, God is with us. God is with us doesn't mean Jesus. It means God is with us. All of us. It's in us. So this happened the other day. It was either last night or the night before. I was given this really, really trippy kind of a vision. And it looks kind of like this. I made a note here. I'm going to read it to you verbatim. So there's this vision of the presence of Christ being like one neuron in your brain. The Christ neuron, let's call it. You got that so far? You got a brain, and the brain is symbolic of your mind, your consciousness, your soul. So think when I'm saying brain, it also means soul, but I'm using cellular topic or context. So it's the soul is the brain. So in the brain, there's neurons, which are all thoughts and experiences of my consciousness. In everyone, there's a neuron that is a Christ neuron. So this is how it comes. There's a presence of Christ like one neuron in our brain trying to transform the rest of the brain. Does that make sense? Can I hear an amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And, yes, Jesus. So in the brain, there's a Christ neuron trying to transform the rest of the brain. This is what came to me. This is an image of how religion sees Jesus.
Amen.
Which is great. Hey, Christ neuron, please change the world for us. Not a bad thing, because there's a Christ neuron. Then here's the next one. Then I was shown a vision of a particle of light within each neuron, not one Christ neuron, to transform the rest, but a particle of light within each neuron that represents the Christ within each individual neuron. And this is a representation of spirituality and how spirituality sees Christ. Listen to the wording. Religion sees Jesus as the neuron in the brain that's going to change the rest of the neurons. Spirituality sees not Jesus, spirituality sees Christ as the light within each neuron that's going to change each of them. Do you hear the difference? One is we look to Jesus to worship and fix everyone, please. The spiritual one is that light is within each of us and we need to get our act together and awaken it. Quite nice. Yeah. Then I was shown a vision of all those neurons disappearing, leaving only the remaining light within each of them. And that is how God sees each of us. Did you see the progression? Religion sees Jesus as the one and only. Spirituality sees the light of Christ within each. God sees only the light. And so it is. And this is what's happening. The light of God is at first seeming to be just one of us. But then it becomes a part of each of us. And then it becomes all that we are. Then that's the remembrance. Back to who we are. The perfect light. If ever you find yourself looking at someone going, God, they really need some help. They need some work. I don't know if they're going to get it. You're back to the first of those three. Hey, Jesus, fix that person. We're never thinking like God until the people are gone, like the neurons. They fade away and leave only the light that was there in the first place. When Jesus was crucified and wrapped in a burial cloth and put in a tomb, he was there for a short period before he said, now. And when he said, now, so to speak, he did exactly what I just described. The density faded and the light became all that he was. Calling it a light body, call it anything you want, but he burst into pure, perfect light. But the thing is that we hear about later, he could still manifest, he could still materialize all the way to density. Go ahead, touch. Thomas, go ahead. And he's also saying, you know, it's a bummer that you have to see to believe. And he's not criticizing, that's what it sounds like he's doing. He's not criticizing. What he's saying is, there will come a time where you will not need to see with your dense eyes that only see limitation to make itself think it believes in something, which doesn't make any sense. That's like a psychosis. I need to see it with my non-real eyes that are being run from my deluded brain that makes me think in my mind that I'm a limited human being. And as long as I can see something based on all of that, I'll know it's real. That makes no sense at all. Instead, I get it. These eyes can't show me the real world. I have the eye that is single. This eye has to open. My spiritual eye. That cannot happen if I'm simultaneously insisting on the other eyes. And I'm insisting on the other eyes when I want what I want, how I want it, without growing in consciousness. And I'm seeing with those other eyes when I believe in the world I see having power over me. And it does not. And a lot of people go, oh gosh, you know, I'm failing in that test because, you know, I'm having a sickness. The sickness is not the failure. The belief that it has power over you is the failure. So I have to cure it. No, that's seeing it again with your eyes. To be enlightened does not mean you don't have a sickness. It means you can still dance and say, hey, no matter what it looks like, I don't go by these eyes. I'm going to dance. Isn't it funny how my ego tells me I'm this, but no. Oh, you know, dancing, you know, and then there's shames in my body, you know, I'm kind of not in shape anymore. All the more reason. Don't do it in this room, but all the more reason. All the more reason. Dance. Dance. Strip off your clothes and go around your house if you live alone and dance and twirl. Because if you were three, you would do it no matter what you looked like. And Jesus says, you want to know what it's like to be in heaven? It's to be like a child who drops their clothes and dances around and tramples their clothes and laughs at them. It's because the mind has no judgment. It has no thoughts of that nature. To the pure in heart, this is written in the tantric manuals, and it's also in the Bible. To the pure in heart, all things are pure, and to the wicked, all things are wicked. All the people you know, including yourself, who judges and finds fault, that's the wicked mind seeing wicked things. Oh, I'm not judging them. I'm just pointing them out. One of those BS artists, you know, of the new age, you know? As long as I can say it calmly, that person is, let me check in my guides, a jerk. That doesn't work. Who are you telling this to? You're not in your divine mind. I'm not saying someone might not look tall or short, you know, but still the fact that you think they're a body that's tall or short is actually still a judgment that they're a body. So don't get too hooked on it all. Don't get too stuck on it all. Be able to laugh at it. In fact, be able to say, God, isn't this funny? Even though I know what I know, wow, look how easily I can still slip and laugh at it. Laughing at it means although it seems serious, I'm not giving it the power I used to. If you get stuck in it, oh my God, I shouldn't have thought that. You're actually proving you're taking it seriously, which means you think it's true. And then you're caught again. To be able to laugh at ourselves does not mean just like at things that are shaming, you know. I'm talking, and never laugh at people. But to learn to laugh at the way we see the world, it's actually righteous to do so. So I would say recently I could see my own life, in some ways, like all of us, coming to a crossroads. And I remember when I was younger on tour, I was teaching individuals, and on tour too, groups, but I was teaching a lot of individuals. And so I'm like teaching spiritual growth, but to individuals. And then, and I did that for years and years and years and years and years, came to Unity of Sedona, and it's not just individuals. Now there's a group. And I had a group of people that would come out to my retreat once in a while, and we would have groups, but that was a few times a year. So I went from teaching individuals, and now, even though they're large numbers of people, they were still felt like individuals. I'm teaching the individuals in a room, a center, a church, or whatever. Now it's a group of us. You're still individuals to me, but there's a group of us walking through this process to another level. It's different than what I was doing for 25 years or whatever it was originally. Now, now it's 35 years, let's say. But I can see something else is calling. Even then, something else is calling. And I don't think it's just me. I think people are hearing a spiritual calling to go to another level. And I'm seeing now it's time for me to get involved with something that would be more global. Now, I'm already seen globally on the internet, and I've already been around the world and teaching around the world. I don't mean just literally. I'm saying I can feel like there's projects, like I've talked about Edenshire, a community someday. But I'm not into communes, but this is a community. It's different. But my idea is that this is about affecting the world, individuals, groups, the world. And I'm okay if that's not going to be me. I can hear the calling for it. I know that I can step into it. And I know, and let's all know this, everything we've done up to this point is preparing us for the next piece. Do not lose sight of that. You may not know how. You may even think, I never had children, I had adopted children, and I raised them, and you might think that's why you were here. You might find that you're actually helping other dads and moms who need advice about kids. That might be part of your purpose. And that means that other stuff wasn't just about buying cute outfits for the children of your partner. It was preparation. One of the weirdest ones I can share about my life, and it's simple, is years ago, my wife at the time, and I think we were married at the time, and then also after, she had a spiritual center and opened a second one for that matter. So she had spiritual centers, and she would run them like a metaphysical bookstore. Kind of cool. It was beautiful. And when I wasn't on tour, I'd like to hang out there because that's where spiritual people are laughing and they're hanging out. So I'd go there and all that. And I would teach once in a while. And then one thing led to another where she needed more help. And next thing I knew, she's like, Michael, can you help me buy incense? Well, yeah, I love scent. And so I help her buy incense. And that's fine. I'm giving advice. I'm a spiritual teacher. I'm good at giving suggestions and advice. And it was beautiful. So I'm helping. And you helped people in the past. But where I thought it really got weird, as you might have assumed in your life, is when she started asking me to sell $1.50 incense over the counter and stand behind the counter because she was struggling. I loved doing it, but I realized, how in the hell did I end up selling incense when I'm a spiritual teacher that's supposed to be traveling the world still? I'm on tour last week and people are, oh, Michael, whoa, we love your teachings. Next week, that'll be $1.62 with tax. It was like, what was that? What kind of nightmare did I walk into? I loved the energy. I loved the sense. But I realized it felt humiliating. Was it? No. That was me. That was my problem. But it felt humiliating. So I'm like, okay, fine. So eventually she closed, and I'm like, thank you, God. She closed the center, the last one, and she moved and did other things with her life. And then I was asked 15 years, 10 years later, whatever, would you come and be our spiritual leader at Unity of Sedona? And after all the discussions around that, fine. I gave in and said, okay, yeah, I'll come and do it. So I come and do it. One of the first things I said you guys have to do, first, turn the seats so we have a nice background instead of the bricks. Secondly, we're going to raise the consciousness. We got to raise the bar on the quality of conversations and teachings and chaplains and music, everything. Raise the bar. Let's get spiritual stuff happening. So we did that. The third thing was those offices back there that looked like hell. There were like six giant desks with paper everywhere. I said, burn them. Take them outside first, but burn them. I said, get rid of the desks. Oh, no, but we need the... No, you don't need the desks. Got rid of them. got rid of all the papers that were sitting on them, and we turned it into a bookstore. Spiritual, you know, gifts and crystals and, oh, that's right, incense. So when they said, but we don't know anything about opening a store, I'm like, I do. And you know what else? I still had the catalogs in storage. That period that I loved with the people and the scents, I loved it, but I did feel confused why I was meant to be teaching an on-tour, and I was already doing that for so many years, and ended up so many days of the week in this store selling incense. And then all these years later, it's one of the most important things we've done here is to say, let's have a place where people can also get things they need. So you don't know how it's going to go. You don't know what it's going to look like. And when it comes to your soul's purpose, some of the weirdest things you've ever experienced end up becoming part of the soul's purpose definition. Your eyes may not agree. And I'm eternally grateful for the experience of that. I'm eternally grateful, and I get the humor of it. God, I even got the catalogs. I'm like, oh my God, you know? And get the catalogs, and then you know what else? As I'm on tour all the time now, I tell churches, centers that I'm at, why don't you guys have a store? You have people coming here to learn. Why don't you have the books for them to learn from? And they're going, well, we don't know how. Without charging or anything, I give them the outline on how to do it. It's easy. Anything can be easy when you're not resisting it. Anything, when you step into it properly and with the right, the guidance and the inspiration. So I can see the shifts that have gone on in my life. So I'm asking you, as we're coming to a close, the only time when we come to these crossroads and things don't open up, something's being postponed, something's blocked, and it behooves us to recognize. If it's blocked, it can only mean a couple of things. You think you have an inspiration, but it's not happening. First, it might not be an inspiration. It might be a memory. You can have a memory of another lifetime. Meet someone you knew in another lifetime. Wow, I've never felt such familiar feelings. I feel like I know you and we're just meeting. Oh my God, I do, you know? And then you marry them, and then about a week later, you'll have this vivid memory of how they murdered you in some other lifetime. I knew I knew them from somewhere. Can I say I don't? You know? People keep working on these gross compulsions. Slow it down. Check in. When you think you have an inspiration and it's not happening, first, are you sure it's an inspiration? Because if it's not, I don't want to burn up energy in it if it's not meant to be. So check it out. It could be that it wasn't an inspiration. It could be a memory. It could also be something that's kind of a symbolic thing. When Helen receives, you're going to write A Course in Miracles. Jesus might have never channeled one single page to her. And she would have been, but you told me I'm going to channel this thing called A Course in Miracles. He could have said, yes, I meant a concept, not a book. I just meant you're going to learn something in your own mind. When you get an inspiration that says, you hear this voice or a psychic tells you, they're channeling it saying, you're supposed to write a book and it's going to change your life. Here's what humans do. Oh, ka-ching. I'm going to write the next whatever, you know, big selling book. I knew it. I'm supposed to write a book, and then you write it. And it sits on pallets in your garage. And strange thing, not one person has ever asked you for one. So God misled you, no. If you could interview God, God, I'm confused. And when you get to the other side, you'll do this. Can we talk about that book that is sitting in the pallets of my garage that I'm now haunting because I can't let go of it, so I'm now haunting my garage, and you have new residents of the house, and I'm the being that they're having to call paranormal people to come out and get out of their garage because I'm still stuck on the energy of my pallet of books in the garage? Can we talk about that, God? God will say, what would you like to know? Well, you told me to write the book, and no, I never said that. Well, the way I said it was, you write your book, and it'll change your life. I meant for you to write the book for you. Just one copy for you. And it was a metaphor to write the book. All I meant was get the stuff out. Get your grief out. Get your memories, your losses, your hurts. Get them out. I didn't mean to type them. And I certainly didn't mean anybody else wanted to hear about it. So. Tears. So it's an inspiration. You know, when you, it feels like it's love and you feel unattached, one copy, a million copies. All I know is, first, when I get that guidance, I being any of us, when I get that guidance, I feel like something is happening, and it is. You're right. Something is processing through me, and you're right. And I feel like there'll be some changes in my world, and you're right. What we don't know is anything beyond that. Does it turn into a book? Is it a lecture you do? One time only? Or is it you just tell your friends? And the answer is, I don't know, but I'm willing to find out. Stay unattached to where you think it's supposed to go. Because that always, that material, I want to see God and I want to see the book, selling lots of copies, that's where humans most go wrong with their inspirations. And what's really a drag, it really hurts our feelings. When we thought we had an inspiration to write a movie, to write a book, and nobody listens. We go to our grave feeling very confused and upset. And once you reach the other side, you're going to be like, oh, I get it. A spiritual V8. I should have had a V8. You know, I should have had... It's an old commercial. You have to be old to know what that means. But if it's feeling loving, if it's feeling inspiring, if it feels like it makes a difference, then step into it. As soon as you start going, but why, then I might have been off somewhere. I was wanting my eyes to be satisfied with the outcome. What if you're inspired to have a child? And this child is going to change the world. It's the next coming of Jesus. That's what it's telling me. It says I'm going to have a child, and you know, baby Jesus. And it's going to change the world. Oh my God, this is the next such and such. And what if your child passes away a few years later? It all went wrong. Something happened. No, your interpretation. You thought it meant they're going to live forever and they're going to change the world the way you thought they were going to change the world. How do you know they didn't change the world in those 3 years? And most importantly, how did they not change your world? That might be the only reason they were there. Is that making sense? So we have to not only listen to inspirations differently, but please get out of the habit of putting it on God that it's going to go a certain way. And then in the context of this talk, because that leads us to not trusting God anymore. So the last thought. Learning that God has such love and compassion for us that it's not there testing us and it's not messing with us, even though I make light some of the ideas behind it, it's not doing any of that. It's saying, I love you so much and can only love you that when you want something, anything in your life, I'm already designing it to happen. What, getting the thing? No, getting the consciousness, because that's what brings you home. Try to feel that for a second. That absolute love. That absolute unchangeable love. I want you to come home. And I'm really sorry, God says. I'm really sorry that so many people don't get that and they struggle. They keep interpreting literally and then I don't match them literally and then they hate me for it. But they're not hearing it properly. I want to give you everything. And you're asking for a thing. But you can't get everything, you know, if you don't let go. It's all this concept of surrender. You want a thing. You're looking at the world this big, and I'm trying to give you everything. So if you want to only go a baby step at a time, sure, God says, if that's what you want to do. I would love to see everyone willing to make quantum leaps. But if you want baby steps, so be it. The guidance has to feel loving. And if it doesn't feel loving and inspiring, even if it sounds good, I'm going to write a book and change the world, don't jump to it. ask what it means in here first. What does writing the book mean in my soul? Not how many you'll sell. What does it mean to me? I am the book. And when it says it'll change my life, oh, wow, it's going to change my consciousness. You see? Go here first for all meanings and you'll almost never be wrong. Go here first and you'll almost always be wrong. So we learn the easy way or the hard way. Trust in God. Let's please take a few centering breaths. I'm going to share a couple of decrees based on awakening the spiritual self. First, resting the body, the human self, breathing. Gradually reflecting on what you heard today that made the most sense, so that you can breathe it in and let it be yours. And we say to you, Father, Mother, God, in this moment, we recognize we have an old self. We recognize and accept that we have an old self with old beliefs, old patterns, old experiences. They are not yet perfect light. We recognize there's a part of us that would like to think that out there is the Christ neuron that's going to fix us all. But we're learning quickly to understand that that same light is within each of us. And it is the Christ light, the consciousness of God within mankind. And we're also learning that soon enough, all the one will fade and there'll only be the light. But of these three, I choose not to live in the first one anymore. At the very least, I choose to accept the light within myself. When Revelation says, only the Lamb is worthy to open my seals, my chakras, and clear them out, the Lamb is that light of Christ, the divine within us all. I call upon that, not my ego, not my head, not my brain, not my limited thinking, not even upon my experiences. I call upon the light of God within me. And I say, you, beloved Christ self, you, beloved purity, remembrance of God, descend into my being with the blessing of the Divine Mother or Holy Spirit. Descend into my being now and begin opening one after another of my spiritual chakras or centers. Open them, open them, open them, and let them reveal all the stuff in them that is unlike God, so that it cannot inhibit me anymore. Any of my physical perceptions, intellectual perceptions, emotional experiences, all of them, I'm open. And let them, like the book of Revelation describes, these things flying up from the abyss. They're coming from the deep recesses of each center. They're opening and opening and opening. All that is unlike God, gently, lovingly, carefully being taken out. I cry them out, I cough them out, I spit them out, I curse them out. All that stuff goes and leaves me empty, to be filled with love and light. I joyously surrender my body and soul to the Spirit of God and allow myself to be filled with the truth of who I am. I joyously accept the knowingness that today the peace of God envelops me and I forget all things except your love, my Father, Mother, God. What could restore your memory to me except to see my brothers and sisters' perfection and purity, sinlessness? Therefore, I choose to see my brother and sister's sinlessness, their purity instead. In my brothers and sisters, I find myself and the memory of God itself. In quiet forgiveness wipes away my dreams of separation. As I learn to use my holy vision, I no longer see errors or fears of myself or others. All such things disappear. Even my body and the world I see begin to fade away. to be replaced by the version of these things that you, Father, Mother, God, created in the beginning. It's that perfect light. Let me look within myself and within brothers and sisters and find that your promise, God, your promise of our purity and sinlessness has been kept all along. Your word remains unchanged within my mind. Your love is still abiding in my heart. Your children are like to you in perfect sinlessness, perfect perfection, perfect love, perfect peace, perfect joy. And with this thought, I gladly say amen. I am as God created me, I will to be the Christ on earth. I joyously accept the knowingness that God's voice speaks to me all through the day. Father, Mother, God, I remember you are here and I am not alone. I have no cause for anything except the perfect peace and joy I share with you. I have no need for anger or fear as I am surrounded by perfect love, stillness, and safety. Your eternal promise goes with me everywhere I go. You created me in holiness, as perfect as your own, and in this holiness I remain. I am as God created me, I will to be the Christ on earth. I joyously accept the knowingness that I am surrounded by the love of God. Today I let all things be as you, Father, Mother, God, created them, and I give your children the honor due them. Today I leave creation free to be itself. I honor all its parts in which I am included. I am one with each part which contains your memory. It's like the cells in those neurons, and truth must shine in all of us as one. Through this, I am redeemed. Through this, the truth will enter where illusions were. Light will replace darkness, and I know I am as you created me. I am as God created me. I will to be the Christ on earth. I joyously accept the knowingness that God is with me wherever I go. I live and breathe in you, Father, Mother, God. Your spirit is my only guide and walks with me in love. I give thanks to you for showing me the way to go. You are my source, my home, my comforter. You are the light that shines within me and within the food I eat and the water that renews me. You are the spirit which directs me and creates a loving world through me. You are in everything I see because you are in my mind. I am as God created me. I will to be the Christ on earth. I joyously accept the knowingness that your ways, Father, Mother, God, are certain and sure in their outcome. Every step in my salvation is already set and accomplished by your grace. Your blessings shine upon me from within my heart where you abide. Thanks and praise to you, my Father, Mother, God, for your eternal gifts, and thanks to you for my true identity. The praise and glory of my Father, Mother, God is also my own. I am as God created me. I will to be the Christ on earth. And lastly, I joyously accept the knowingness that by the authority of my Christ self, I call to all souls around the earth. Wake up and know ye are gods and goddesses. Father, Mother, God, use me in every way, any way, and every way possible to assist in the awakening of my true self and the true self of others, and from all the dreams we've made. I will use this key to become a master and take dominion over my life and the world around me, just as was ordained in the beginning. God's all-pervading wisdom now replaces all ignorance in my being and in the collective consciousness. I am as God created me, I will to be the Christ on earth. And we allow that presence to be in us as us. We allow it to gently breathe its light into each center as we're filled with this beautiful remembrance. The holy breath of the Holy Spirit, the holy breath of the Divine Mother, she breathes into each center the awakening of our Christ self. And we see and feel each center glowing gently and brightly. And when those centers are activated, they activate my meridians of light, the puncture points and vortexes throughout my body, and it illuminates as an aura around me. And I shine brightly as the light of God. And this brightness I am, which is any of us, we also see excites the earth. The earth recognizes there's a light being born right now, and she enters a reciprocal relationship with us where she can draw some of that light for her healing and give us some of her light for our healing. Her light can come in the form of energy or herbs, the form of foods, waters, And we give back unconditional love to her because of the symbol of what she is. Unconditional love. And all around the earth, let's picture it, chakras of the earth and acupuncture points of the earth and meridian lines of the earth being activated because of our work here today. And there are people watching from all around the planet, so they're activating it anyway where they live. But it's a grid system. We activate this one and it activates another one. And downstream, everything starts lighting, becoming illuminated. This is the world that seems unseen. We need not beg the one Christ neuron out in the brain to go and fix our misperceived world. Instead, we choose to see the light of the world that God put there in the first place. And we're part of that light. And we feel this and we give abundant thanks that we are the light of the world. And as Jesus said, which also stands for all of us, and no one reaches the Father, Mother, God, but through me, which is the light. I cannot reach God without activating my light, without becoming this light. And living as though I am this light. Behaving as though I'm this light. And extending it to all other people. Father, Mother, God, we close by saying, help us to forgive ourselves for losing trust in you. When we did, we lost trust in ourselves. And then we lost trust in each other. And we close with these words. Remember, I love you. When we say it, I means God, love is self, you is others. So we can all hear and feel the words, I love you, and know what it means is not the human romanticized thing. It means God in me, as love in me, God that is, as love in me, extends to you and all others. Three times I love you, knowing what it really means to all people together. I love you. I love you. I love you. And with this, all things are possible. And so it is. All right. Nice.